A warm welcome to Colchester Zoo and Love Your Zoo Week. Colchester Zoo is fast approaching its 50th anniversary. Started off from fairly humble beginnings and opened in May 1963, and over the last 30 years or so, it's developed into the huge conservation centre that it is today. The park was originally opened in 1963 by Mr. Frank Farrer in the grounds of Stanway Hall. This was thought to be an absolutely ideal backdrop to a zoo. It had wonderful gardens and close proximity to Colchester, Ipswich, London and Cambridge. The zoo remained in the ownership of Mr. Farrer through the 70s and into the very early 1980s. But by this time he was unfortunately suffering some ill health and the zoo had fallen into some disrepair. Not only were the numbers of animals in the park dwindling, but also were the numbers of visitors that were coming through the gate. My family officially took over in 1983, and those first few years were spent trying to put a face onto the park and to enable us to comply to the Zoo Licensing Act. It was from this small start was the springboard to greater things. Those early days were not without their setbacks. The hurricane in October 1987 undid a lot of the great work that had been done up to that point. That particular evening, we lost a number of enclosures, including several spectacular trees. The zoo was actually without electricity for 6 days, and if it wasn't for the generosity of the British Army, based locally here at Colchester, who very kindly lent us a generator, it is only through their support that we were able to keep many delicate species alive. Those early years were spent knocking down as many of the old enclosures that we could and replacing them with newer ones. In turn, through evolution, some of those enclosures have now disappeared as well as the zoo has transformed from one period to another. 1989 saw us open our largest and most themed exhibit to date. This was called Tiger Valley and it was opened to coincide with the Federation of Zoos Year of the Cat. The enclosure originally housed orange Amur tigers, but the enclosure became better known as White Tiger Valley when Sasha, a white tiger that many regular visitors will know, lived in the exhibit for many years. The construction style of Tiger Valley was designed to be a mini habitat, and it also allowed visitors to come face to face with these beautiful predators with the use of glass. Tiger Valley was an extremely good example of just how well captive animals can support their wild counterparts. Fundraising in the exhibit reached a total of over £40,000, which was donated to a number of charities working with tigers in the wild. The style of enclosure was carried on through right until the present day. The next big milestone was perhaps an exhibit called Out of Africa, used to house colobus monkey, which actually won the University's Federation for Welfare Award in 1991. The 1990s saw not just an increase in the number of enclosures at the zoo, but other facilities as well, such as toilets, paths, bins, catering outlets and retail outlets. It really was a question of bringing a whole brand new feel to the zoo. By 1996, however, it was felt that the zoo was beginning to burst at its seams a little bit, and in order for us to expand further, we would need to look at extra land. We entered into negotiations to buy some extra land, about 25 acres in all, in which the zoo could expand. This land was a mixture of a flat field at the bottom end of the zoo, which would be where the public part of the zoo would expand to, and we also had the opportunity to build and buy some barns and yard areas which were much needed for maintenance and storage. By this time the zoo's reputation was beginning to grow. Unfortunately, visitors were starting to flock back to the park. And it was at this time, towards the end of the 1990s, that we decided that we needed to reinvest in our front entrance facilities. We sought planning permission for the first of three very large buildings that were to join the zoo over the following years. The main entrance building was moved so that visitors could first park their cars before entering into the zoo. Planning permission was granted for the flat field at the bottom of the zoo in 1997-98, and the first job that we needed to do was to landscape the whole area by bringing in earth moving equipment and planting many thousands of trees. 1999 saw the completion of our largest building to date, the new Elephant House, which was to house our group of five elephants. Shortly after that, work began on Spirit of Africa. This was the building that was to house giraffes, rhinos, ostrich, kudu, and many other African mixed animals. And this was completed in 2000. But all this development was put at significant risk on the 19th of February 2001 with the outbreak of foot and mouth disease at an abattoir in Essex. A farm very close to the zoo also contracted the disease in its flock of sheep, and it was at this stage that the zoo was put into an exclusion zone and its gates remained shut for the next 6 weeks. It was an extremely traumatic time. We had no idea when we would be able to reopen, and of course we had absolutely no income throughout this period. It was only through the support of visitors that attended to us very heavily during the rest of the year that the zoo is still here today to be able to tell this story. 2004 saw the zoo's charity Action for the Wild reach charitable status. Beginning in 1984, this was just a mechanism by which we donated money to a Golden Lion tamarin project in Brazil. But over the following years, we were donating to a number of different charities, and we felt that it was vital that Action for the Wild reach charitable status itself. It now employs full-time members of staff. This year it's donating to over 13 projects, and over the last 5 years it has donated over £500,000 to wildlife conservation. In addition, it is also the umbrella organisation which overlooks Umfafa, the zoo's own private game reserve in South Africa. The turn of the millennium saw one of the most important births ever in the history of Colchester Zoo. Keto, our first elephant calf, was born in December 2002. He was the first elephant born in the UK through artificial insemination, so he made countrywide headlines. 2 years later, a young elephant called Jambo was born to a female called Rosa through natural mating. The new millennium also saw us continue to develop. Our most expensive and ambitious project was started in 2003, which was the construction of Playa Patagonia, our new pool for sea lions. Costing over £1.75 million, it remains still the most expensive project that we've undertaken. Despite this, we continue to reinvest into the park. And years after, new enclosures for our Komodo dragons, orangutans, and the Wilds of Asia extension all took place. The zoo has grown beyond all recognition. In 1983, there were just 7 keepers to look after the animal collection. Now there are 65 keeping staff amongst a total staff of over 300. It is only through the generosity and the support of the some 500,000 people that now come to visit us every year that we continue with this good work. And I'd just like to finish by saying a big thank you to everybody that has visited the zoo today and over the last 30 years.